Hi everyone and welcome back to the channel, and this would be part 2 of the chapter of professional ethics. And in this video we'll be discussing on the clauses of the first schedule of the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. So the first schedule, it has 4 parts. So the first part will deal with professional misconduct with members in practice. Part 2 is professional misconduct related to members in service. Part 3 is professional misconduct applicable to both those in practice and in employment. And the fourth part is on other misconduct. So part 1, which deals with professional misconduct of members in practice, has 12 clauses. Part 2 has 2. Part 3 has 3 clauses. And part 4 has 2 clauses. So totally there are 19 clauses in the first schedule of the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. So what we will do now is we will be discussing in a brief manner the provisions of each clause that are there in this first schedule. So first we'll have a look at the provisions that are there as part of part 1 of this schedule, which deals with practicing chartered accountants. So we will look at clause 1 and clause 12 together. Clause 2 and 3 go together, 2, 3 and 4 rather. Clause 5, 6 and 7 will be read together. Clause 8, clause 9, clause 10 and 11, these are separate. So there are totally one group, the second group, the third group and the others. So there are three groups plus everything else. So clause 1 is: if a chartered accountant in practice allows any person to practice in his name, that is, if he allows any person other than his own partner who is also a chartered accountant in practice or his employee to practice in his name, he should not be allowing anyone else to practice in his name. So for example, if we take XYZ and Associates, which is a chartered accountant firm, there can be three partners, X, Y and Z. So each of them can practice in the name of the firm, and if there are any employees in the firm who are chartered accountants, even they can practice in the name of the firm. That is, the employees will also be representing the firm. But if there is anyone else apart from the partners and employees, they cannot be allowed to practice in the name of the firm. That is, they won't be representing the firm. They can't have any signing authority or any authority on behalf of the firm. So that is what clause 1 says. Now we'll move to clause 12, which is very closely related to the first clause. So here is clause 12. So clause 12 is allows any person not being a member of the institute in practice or his partner to sign on behalf of the firm. That is, if in the same example which we were dealing with now, XYZ and Associates. So in this case, only partners X, Y and Z can be signing on behalf of the firm. The employees do not have the signing authority on behalf of the firm. That is, wherever the member has to perform the attest function, only the partner who is a member will be performing the attest function. That is, only X, Y and Z can perform the attest function and everyone else cannot be performing this function of signing. So they are just employees. They cannot sign the main financials like balance sheet, P&L, any report or financial statements. The only thing that they can do is sign in any checklists if necessary, or inventory statements. Whatever does not have a statutory recognition, those things can be signed by the employees. But anything which is having a statutory recognition, only the partners can be signing that. With that, we have completed the first group here, that is clause 1 and clause 12. Now we move on to the second group, which is clause 2, 3 and 4. So clause 2 here, it deals with a case where a member in practice is sharing his profits with someone else. So the gist of this particular clause, in the exam you may have to quote most of the portion that they have given here, but the gist of this particular clause is that if a member in practice is sharing his profits with someone else, then it is only with a limited set of persons with whom he can be sharing his profits. He cannot be sharing his profits from his profession with everyone else. Now, who are those limited set of persons? That is given in Regulation 53A, Sub-Regulation 1. So, there are 5 institutes which they have given here. So, whoever is a company secretary or a cost accountant, so if they have just cleared the final exam of these institutes, then they would be called as a CS or a cost accountant or an actuary or an engineer. So, with those people, the chartered accountant can share his profits. That is whatever he is getting as part of his professional earnings, that can be shared with these people. And the next point here, this goodwill, it's pretty simple. It's just that the goodwill of the firm can be sold to anyone else if it is in case of a sole proprietorship firm. And they have given the dates here because the regulation was amended in 1998. Clause 3 is opposite of Clause 2. Clause 2 was regarding sharing the earnings. Clause 3 is accepting the earnings from anyone else. So, this same set of persons, the chartered accountant can be accepting the earnings. And anyone else, he cannot be accepting their earnings as part of whatever is shared, he cannot be accepting that. Clause 4 is again a derivative of 2 and 3 itself. It is closely connected. Clause 2 and 3 was just with sharing the earnings and getting the share of the earnings, whereas clause 4 is regarding partnership. So, the chartered accountant in practice can enter into partnership with a very limited set of persons. Those persons are specified in Regulation 53B, Sub-Regulation 2. So, 53A, what we saw was the set of persons with whom the earnings can be shared or a share can be taken. But here it goes into a little more detail. If you look here, it was just company secretary within the meaning of Company Secretaries Act. But here it is company secretary who is a member. In all the cases here, it has to be a member itself. So the CA can enter into a partnership only with the members. So even if they are just company secretary within the meaning of that act, he cannot be entering into a partnership with them. He can just be sharing his earnings or getting the share. But if he wants to enter into a partnership, they have to be members of these institutes. And now we move on. We have done the first group as well as the second group. Now we move on to clause 5, 6 and 7, which are pretty big and have a lot of details that are given here. So clause 5 is securing the clients through a person who is not his partner or his employee. So if a chartered accountant is getting clients from anyone else who is not his partner or his employee, or by any means which is not open to a CA. So by any means which is not open to a CA, it means that any kind of unfair means or unethical means, he cannot be getting the clients. And clause number 6, it deals with soliciting of clients or professional work by circular, advertisement, interview or any other means. But they have given an exception for this, that is a CA in practice can get work on an assignment basis from another CA in practice. So that particular thing is allowed, and also responding to tenders or inquiries. So even in the tenders, there are exception to an exception, which means that this particular thing is not allowed for the member to be doing. That is, if the whatever job which is being given floated through a tender, if it is exclusively reserved for CAs, then he cannot be responding to that. But if it is open for anyone to respond, or if the minimum fees has already been prescribed, then in such a case, the CA in practice can respond. So the main clause 6, it talks about soliciting clients through advertisement or interviews or such other means. That is not allowed. But if he can get work from on an assignment basis from other CAs, that is allowed. And he can't be responding to tenders in general, except where the minimum fees is already prescribed, and if it is open for members from other professions as well to respond. In such a case, it is approved. And the other main important thing about clause 6 is issuing of greeting cards or invitations, and also issuing marriage invitations. That is, the CA can put his designation as a chartered accountant in his marriage invitation. And one more important thing about clause 6 is regarding the website. So there are things which are given here in this particular paragraphs regarding website. They may not actually seem to be working in the practical sense, because they have said that they can't be advertising their services, or they can't be giving a write-up of what they do and such other things here. But if you look at the many online forums and platforms, the CAs, their particular achievements or their background or their clients would have been mentioned there. So for the exam, you just have to read whatever is given here and go and write it. You can't be questioning what they have given in this book for the exam purpose. But apart from that, whatever is practically happening, it is not as per what is given in the book. And next we move to clause 7. So website is a very important thing in clause 6, and there have been questions. And clause 7 deals with advertising of professional attainments or using designations other than that of a chartered accountant. So this clause 7, in the previous video I told that it is very closely connected with section 7 of the Chartered Accountants Act. So clause 7 deals with usage of designations other than a chartered accountant. So if he is a CA in practice, then he can use only the designation of a chartered accountant. He can't be using other designations when he is practicing as a CA. So it will only be CA XYZ, and it can't be CA, CS, CMA, XYZ. It will only be one COP. And an exception is given here regarding that a member may advertise through a write-up. So what should be that write-up? That is given here, Council General Guidelines for Advertisement. So this particular guidelines gives on what basis the write-up should be there prepared, and what should be the language or the manner in which that write-up is provided. And so clause 5, 6, 7, it mostly deals with what kind of advertisements or how to attract clients and such other things. What is the ethical way of getting clients and what is the unethical way, that the CA cannot be advertising that he is performing such and such services, and he can't be disclosing his clients' names or fees. He can't be disclosing his professional attainments, and if he goes to interviews, he can't be disclosing the name of the firm. Rather, it will just be his name and that he is a chartered accountant. He can't be saying from which firm he has come. And now we move on to clause 8, which is a different group. So now we are done with clause 1 and 12, clause 2, 3, 4, clause 5, 6, 7. Now we are dealing with clause 8. So clause 8 deals with an assignment where the member in practice, he is accepting an assignment which was earlier handled by another CA in practice. So if it was handled by another CA in practice, this chartered accountant will have to communicate with that previous person and ask if there are any professional reasons for not accepting such an assignment. And the prescribed method given here is registered post acknowledgement due. So he'll have to communicate with the person through a registered post, and if he does not get the reply within a prescribed period of time, within a sufficient period of time, then he can go ahead and take a decision, or else he'll have to wait to get the reply of that preceding member. And in case if the person does not communicate to the predecessor in writing, that is a professional misconduct and it is a punishable offense. And the next clause is clause number 9. This is kind of connected with the previous clause, but it is only applicable for audits of companies and not in other cases. Clause 9 deals with a case that if the person is accepting an appointment as an auditor of the company, he will have to verify that the company has complied with these four sections. So 139, 140, 141 and 142, both the auditor as well as the company will have to comply with this section. In case he has not verified compliance and the company is not in compliance with these sections, he will be punished as given in that matrix. That is, it will go to the board of discipline and such things later on. Next would be clause number 10. Clause 10 deals with a case where the chartered accountant in practice is performing an assignment on a percentage basis. That is, he can charge fees based on percentage of whatever is the matter under consideration only in very limited circumstances. They are given under the regulation 192, which we will be looking at here. But in normal cases, the chartered accountant cannot charge fees as a percentage of the profits or the percentage of the matter involved. So the percentage can be charged in very limited circumstances, and that is given in this regulation 192. So this is an exception to clause number 10. So in these cases, the chartered accountant in practice can charge his fees based on a percentage. That is, in case of a liquidator, based on a percentage of the realized assets, and in case of a valuer, based on the percentage of the property value. And these are the new amendments which have been made to this regulation. So all these, the auditor can, a chartered accountant in practice, he can charge his fees on a percentage basis. In any other case, he can't charge it on a percentage basis. It will be either a fixed amount or it can be a variable basis. That is, say the company has a turnover of 100 crore and he charges 1% of the turnover as his fees, that is 1 crore. So it will be a fixed amount of 1 crore. It can't be a percentage of the final figure that will be derived. So after audit, the figure may go up or come down, and in such a case, the audit fees won't go up or come down. It will be fixed as 1 crore. And it won't be, if the revenue number jumps to 110 crore after the audit, it won't become 1.1 crore for the audit fee. It will still remain as 1 crore. So that is the distinction or the meaning of charging on a percentage basis. Clause 11 is engages in any business or occupation which is not permitted by the council. So in the previous video, I had explained, when explaining the meaning of a member deemed to be in practice, what are the kinds of assignments the chartered accountant can be performing. So clause 11 has two types of things that the chartered accountant can do. So for certain work, the council has granted permission on a general basis. That is, any CA in practice can take up these kind of work, or these kind of activities rather. And for certain cases which are coming under the head specific resolution, the CA will have to apply to the council of the institute, get their permission, and only then engage in these activities. So these are the two types of activities which a member can involve in. Even though he is in practice, these activities can be performed. And there are certain cases which are prohibited for a member to be involved in. And for those activities, the chartered accountant in practice cannot be involved. That is, he can't be taking up such activities. Clause number 12, we have already discussed it along with clause 1. So with that, we have completed all the meanings of all the 12 clauses that are there as part of part 1 of the first schedule. So these deal with the professional misconduct for a CA in practice. And now we come to the next part, that is part 2 for a CA in service. And for CA in service, there are only two clauses. Part 1, the clause 1 is paying the share of salary to others, and clause 2 is accepting the share from others. So if a CA in service, if he allows or if he gives his share of salary to anyone else apart from whoever is allowed as per this clause, then that is a professional misconduct. And in clause 2, if he accepts any commission or any profits and gains from anyone else who is not permitted as per this clause, even in such a case, he is considered to have committed a professional misconduct. And then we move on to part number 3 in the first schedule, which deals with chartered accountant in general. So it applies to both who are in practice and in service. And under this, clause 1 deals with falsely acting as a member. So if he is not a fellow of the institute, that is, he either is not a member of the institute at all, or if he is a member but an associate member, but if he acts as a fellow member of the institute, that is a professional misconduct. And clause number 2 is a case where the CA in general, he does not supply the information which is called by the board of discipline or disciplinary committee, QRB, anyone else. So these are statutory authorities or authorities of ICAI. So if he does not supply the information called by them, this is a professional misconduct. So this you will have to again check it with the next part that is given in second schedule, part number 2. So even there a similar provision is there, but it is slightly different. So you, when you are reading this particular clause, that is clause 2 of part 3, you must also read the clause that is given in part 2 of schedule 2. Clause 3 under this part 3, it deals with when inviting professional work from another CA if he gives false information. So this is connected with clause 6 of the first part, so where he was permitted to get work from another CA on an assignment basis. So if he is giving false information, even that amounts to professional misconduct. And part 4 of this particular schedule, it deals with other misconduct. There are two clauses. Clause 1 deals with a case where the CA, he has committed any offense and the term of imprisonment is less than 6 months. So if it is less than 6 months, it comes under this clause. If it is more than 6 months, it goes to the second schedule. And the last clause in the first schedule, which is clause 2 of part 4, it deals with a case where the CA has brought disrepute to the profession. So this, the best example for this particular thing would be a check bounce case. So by, if the CA's check has bounced due to insufficient funds, then it is a case of bringing disrepute to the profession of a chartered accountant, disrepute to the profession of chartered accountancy, and institute can take action if it receives a complaint. So with that, we have come to an end of the first schedule of the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. We have covered all the 19 clauses that are there, and I hope you learned something or learned the meanings of all these clauses that are there. In the next video, I'll be dealing with the second schedule of the act. So thank you for watching, and hope you are there even for the next video as well.